domestic, because it's a class one dwelling, the requirements for fireproofing are minimal, right? Basically, all we have to have is that smoke detector outside of bedrooms. Then if it's a passageway, it's a sort of its own landlocked area, so you only really need one, but whether you're doing or not, they've got to be linked to all the other ones. The other place you need it is if you've got a native flame gas hot pit, glass splashback, something like that, you need fireproofing behind that, because the glass is not classed as fireproofing because it can shatter under heat. And then we have to put a special board behind. Type of board?
Villa
board? Mill board is the best one. Right, mill board is it's a little bit like an asbestos type board. It's very soft, but fire resistant. Okay, but it's expensive. In the scope of things, I used to buy it in there. I think it came in about 900 wide, and I used to get it about 900. That's what it used to do for a few houses.
That's really brittle.
No, it's not brittle. It's very soft. I was going to say like blotting paper, but you wouldn't have a clue what blotting paper was, would you?
It's harder. Yes, we did.
Cure your ears. It's very soft, bendy, flaky. Yeah, very soft. Compared to a cement sheet, it looks similar, but it's a lot softer.
What's it called? Mill.
M-I-double-L.
Buy from the plumber's shops. It's what the plumbers will use behind when they're doing oxy or anything like that, and they need to take the frame. We'll put that behind, because cement sheet actually explodes when it gets hot.
Yeah.
If you throw a piece in the fire, it explodes.
So there's a special sheet.
Yeah. Now you're going to throw it in the fire, right? Yeah. Right, now, the other thing is, buildings, and I think we spoke about this earlier on, about on a boundary, or within 900 of a boundary. We covered that. This company then, I thought we hadn't got out. You all remember that? Yeah. Anything within 900 of boundary has to be fire rated.
Yeah.
60-60-60.
Yeah.
And what the numbers mean? Time, structural integrity, insulation, and combustibility. So in the NCC 3.7, it goes through all the locations, right? So anything within that, and it's only that one left, right? Or that little bit there for a 20 position house on the block.
In regards to the last one, we have to wrap around to the house.
No, it tells you.
As long as it's not 900.
Only the wall facing or parallel to the boundary wall must have an answer. Okay. So it's just that.
Boundary. But if those returns are within 900, you've got to do them as well.
No.
No,
that's like what it says. Yeah. Only parallel to your fence line.
That's
right?
A pretty silly.
So you don't have to do that and that, because the fire's coming that way.
Oh, really?
It doesn't know how to come on an angle.
Okay.
It doesn't know how to come around a corner.
Okay.
Yeah.
When you've got two buildings on the same block, within 1.8 metres of each other. Both have to have, or just one have a fire-resistant wall.
Both. The fire might be going from one to the other, or that one vice versa.
So you have to, okay,
what
it's
not protecting your building. It's protecting your building from the fire that's coming your way.
But on this picture here, like the one you've got up there at the bottom.
There it is. There.
You've only got one wall. One wall shine.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm taking up the roof line.
Sorry?
You have to take the fire protection off your roof.
Onto the roof line. And it's all in that 3.7. It has lots of pretty pictures, and that's how to block it off different ways. That's the one of choice these years. The metal flashing, the metal fascia, and that, rather than, because that way you're losing. It used to be 150mm maximum. So on the boundary are 150mm, right? They've now, I think, moved it up to 200mm. Because 150 doesn't actually, if you've got 125mm fascia, and then a 125mm gutter and a 32mm fascia, it's over the 150. So you've got 200 now, maximum off the boundary. All right. I'll go through lots of pictures here, where you have to have it. That's your 10-year separate marriage. Looking for.
That's interesting.
What you can get away with, that doesn't come into the factor. Separation walls. Tells you about the smoke alarms, okay? Location, bottom of stairs, tops of stairs. On each other story, all right? And location wise, you've got dead areas. That's actually a dead area. The smoke billows was in a circular action. So if you place it right up in the corner, it's not going to be effective. So remember 500 a mil away from the corners. All right? With your heating appliances, flues, chimneys. It's an old fashioned thing there to have an open fire. Anybody got one?
Yep.
Do you have any problems with it, smoking?
I did when I first started up, but then I got up on top of the chimney. Mm. And someone put a cover over there to stop birds coming out, even the tiny little hole coming out of it.
Yeah, so.
Just pull that out before you find.
Yeah. Okay. One of the problems, or some of the problems you can have is smoke billowing, right? Especially on a night like tonight with a lot of wind. It's all to do with wind pressure, right? Because what happens is wind comes up and over the roof and it starts circulating, so it can actually push the pressure back down the chimney. Who's got a combustion fire? When you open it, does it smoke?
No.
No. If you open it too quick, does it smoke?
Depending on the timber you've got in there.
That can be pressure as well, equalising. Once, if you walk, just crack it.
That's because you open the air,
and the pressure it doesn't. Yeah,
that's correct.
So one of the things with fireplaces is the height of the chimney above the roof. And there's a picture in there. Well, you got your hearth. You have the requirements for a hearth to be 300 forward of the front of the fireplace. The fireplace approach should actually slope back over in there so that any logs that roll don't roll out, they roll back over. Okay. This, you read the masonry code, can't be normal mortar. Shouldn't be wire cut bricks, because with wire cut bricks, there's got holes in them. Heat inside there expands, it can actually explode the brick. So you should be using at the least a solid, but there is specific bricks that you can use inside a fire brick, right? Which they use inside kilns and all that. It's a very dense, soft brick.
Really boilers, probably.
You used to be able to get them new,
but it comes up all.
Yeah. Try the big brick companies. You might be able to get secondhand ones as well.
Yeah.
There are specific ones. They're not used as much these days. I've
seen people doing, they make a concrete block out of three bricks. In place of the bricks.
I wouldn't do that either. I think that's recommended concrete.
No, it's a special type. It's not just your regular type.
Oh, yeah. Like doing a pizza oven or something like that. It's just, also, the mortar that you use in there should have a high lime content. The lime expands and contracts, where the mortar sets the vent will expand and cracks and deteriorates. So things like that. But with the chimney, I think it's the next one, that one there. 3.6.
Okay.
3.6 from a horizontal line. Okay, it's not from the ridge. It's 3.6 from there, and then you have to go an extra 300 higher. That's the minimum. Because what can happen is the wind's blowing that way, comes over the ridge, starts bellowing, and push the smoke back down. So if that happens in a fireplace or a chimney or a job like he's doing, and the safety oil, you've got black stains around the top of the fireplace, usually that's a problem. So it needs lifting. Or trees have grown up here and here, and they change the airflow patterns. So you're getting a downdraft. Or you're sitting downhill, the hill's grown while the house has been sitting there. So there's different reasons, but usually that's the reason a chimney smokes. Okay. And really, you should not be able to look up the inside of a chimney and see the birds flying by. Otherwise, you're going to get the weather coming straight down, and you'll get water dripping onto the fire and hissing and whatnot. One of the very first houses we worked on, architect designed, the brickies had come in, made a portion of the brickwork and the fireplace, and you looked up and you could actually see the birds flying by. And we ended up having to pull it down, and my old man had to rebuild the fireplace to put a decent coal in it.
Mine's actually, I've looked at it from inside, it's an actual fireplace, mm-hmm. but I've got a combustion heater in it,
yeah.
and it's actually like... Spiral. Like that, spiral. Yeah. It's like...
Really?
Yeah, it's...
It works like
the brick's
that.
Not, as you say, it's not straight up. It's just, it's weird how they've built it, but it's some good workmanship.
And these days, you've got to have a dampener on it, Bill. For fires. So it's a open, close sort of thing. Mm. With combustion fires, or like you said, Nick, if you've got a combustion fire and you put a flue inside,
literally,
you've got requirements for clearances, right? So any flue, metal flue, that goes through a roof or passes any timber has to be triple skin in that section, and it has minimum clearances from other timbers, 25 mil, right? And that's on the triple skin. If you want to go to twin skin, you've got to have a bigger clearance again. Okay? You need to be aware, and if you are having to put one in, any supplier should be able to give you that sort of information, which is specific to the fire.
A lot of new houses incorporating flues or not?
With the gas fires.
With any sort of like gas fire or log fire or something like that.
All the gas imitation ones do not have the flues installed.
Yeah.
One of the things you've got to be careful with is with the gas fires. I don't know if I'm told you this one. With the glass front on.
Mm-hmm.
Have to be vented.
Yeah, otherwise, yeah.
Have to have fixed ventilation because of the possibility of carbon monoxide buildup if the fire's not working properly. A couple of years ago, 3, 4, 5 years ago, whatever, there's a couple of little kids died because of it.
Yeah.
Well, even the old wall furnaces. Anybody got an old wall furnace?
That's the one I've seen the advertising.
Yeah, we know about them, yeah.
Right?
Yeah, I've seen them. Yeah.
Anyone with an old wall furnace gas fire? They have to have fixed ventilation. So if you remember, or if you're in an older style house, pre-1982, you will have wall vents in every room. Now we don't have them because the heating system's changed. Back then we had gas fires, wall furnaces, whatever it happened to be, and we had this natural ventilation. Well, then it got knocked on the head, so we don't have to put them in anymore. But if you're installing or getting installed a gas fire without the glass front on, so it's an exposed flame, you need the fixed ventilation. If it's got a glass front on, you don't need the ventilation because it's usually working on what's called a balanced flue, where it's pulling air from outside and expelling the air outside. So it's a sealed system. So you don't need it if it goes wrong. And that's it there. Put out the back.
Yeah.
It's 400 millimetres away from the wall.
No.
There is requirements for flues terminating outside from corner. In fact, all plumbing appliances have requirements for where you can position them. For a gas hot water service, for instance, can't go within X amount of a corner.
A window.
A window, below a window.
Your
window.
Well, window opens.
So it is. Standardized sheet, and it tells you where gas appliances can go and where they can't go. So safety zones. Again, it's for gases entering a house, within corners, things like that. You get trapped there. Bushfire areas. Every house now has to be or have a BAL level, whether it's law or going up through the ranks, and it's a letter that you have to have from a qualified bushfire radar.
What's it called again?
A BAL, bushfire attack level certificate.
A BAL.
There is. If you go to the VBA website, there is information you can download to be able to work it out yourself. Personally, I wouldn't recommend it because it's too bloody hard. Because it's all to do with depth, whether you're on the downside of a slope, the upside of a slope, within X amount of vegetation, the type of vegetation, lots and lots of, and I think I've got it on another PowerPoint in another module. It's very technical. And you still need to be qualified. Now, some areas are classed as low. For instance, Frankston South, they declared that as a low area. So it's next to nothing. Well, nothing.
Yes.
Have you been to Frankston South?
I have a house in Frankston South.
Mount Liza. Yeah. It's covered in gum trees. Mm. If we get a fire down there, it's going to go all the way through, past Arthur's Seat, and just keep on going.
All the way to Tasmania.
Bus straight. Can't work that one out. But
my house backs onto a reserve too.
Well, the house is there, and you don't need it anyway. But, some areas have been brought into floor, others are high. goes through and explains what the requirements are depending on your FRL level. Right? The building certificate requires an FRL level. And the higher the risk rating, the bigger the document, the more control measures you have to have.
Would council have that information, like for areas?
For the area, yes.
And do you still have to go and get it for the individual house up?
Yep, because it's going to tell you what actual... Because even a house in the middle of the city has to have an FRL. I mean, where's the bushfire come from in the middle of the city? But it still has to have one. It's just basically a rubber stamp on a piece of paper, but each one has to have one to see, justify to the building surveyor, and then he's going to check the drawing off to see what the requirements are on the drawing for that required level.
So even if you choose to use the municipal building surveyor, paid a huge fees, you'd still have to get an outside expert in to do that thing for you.
A lot of the building surveyors provide that service, I believe, these days. So they'll do a one-stop shop. So oh, okay, as well as doing that, they'll get the stormwater points for you, they'll do the FRL, they'll do the six star. It's just some of them are doing that, but I'm not seeing all of them.
Well, that's funny you should say that, because I went around the weekend to do a little photographing exercise, and I saw seven or eight building sites by different builders, some volume builders, some smaller, and they're all using the same private surveyor group.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Who was it?
Advanced. But they seem to actually do other things, as you were saying.
Yeah, they've become a one-stop shop. It's like when they actually brought in this privatisation of building surveyors, a lot of the smaller builders were dead against it. For the simple fact, they knew what was going to happen with the volume builders. And it basically come true. You know, I know for a fact Simmons have one building surveyor who's doing
all of their homes.
1,800, 2,000 a year. Now, if you're thinking $1,500, $2,000 a permit.
So what's he getting paid?
How does he go around and do all the mandatory inspections? He'd be a police on today.
He allocates people.
You have...
They don't.
A lot of workers.
I work for them. They don't do anything. They don't do anything. The guys running the site will go around and have a look.
They become the relevant building surveyor.
Yep.
And they'll employ building surveyors elsewhere to do it. If they're out of their areas, that sort of thing. Look, they do pick stuff up. How much? I don't know.
Think about it.
If you're making $2-3 million bucks a year out of one builder for a rubber stamp, are you going to make waves? Because as soon as you make waves, where the volume builders are, and this is my opinion again, all they're going to say is, well, sorry, I'll go somewhere else. Whether it happens or not, I have my thoughts on that. Where, from a smaller builder's point of view, once they get familiar with you, it's a lot easier. In the early days, they're pretty well on checking everything and anything. I remember a long time ago, we hadn't been in Australia long, pitched a roof, called for the inspection, and the inspector's come out and looked at it and he's gone, well, I'm going to say you haven't been out here very long because of the way we pitched the roof. We'd actually put a half shoulder underneath the hip on the micas stuck on the underpill, where normally you just put them in there. We did a half, and then we put another piece. Do you know where a dragon tie is? We put a dragon tie in and have the extra prop in and all this sort of stuff, and it's all old school from England. And after that, basically rubber stamps.
Yeah. Well, you saw your dealer properly, that's probably why.
Well,
you've done
I'm not saying better, but it wasn't the easy way. It was a lot more labor intensive. But you know how you get weird with stuff with spears on your business right there?
I've been hearing stories, there's
no idea. No. If you've got a problem that you're happy with, but you know it's not going to come by, we'll just see it's up there. When it comes on site, make sure there's something simple to fix there, and you're standing here and you're having that conversation. So if he's looking past you and he's saying, you go, oh, by the way, oh shit, I meant to do that yesterday and I forgot clean about it. I'll just run out of time. He's happy. He hasn't seen what's behind him that you're looking at thinking,
oh. God, that works.
It works?
Works.
Of course it works.
A week and a half ago. Yeah. And you didn't even go inside. Yeah. It's like, you know, I put a block up against that truss. Yeah. I'm like, yep. And then he just walked. It's like, great.
It justifies the job.
Done the rest of the house.
My father-in-law used to be a clerk of works when I had clerk of works for the plumbing board and water board. And he was telling the story about one inspector, not him. One inspector used to have the old doctor's bag, you know, and he had his mirrors and everything in there. So the first thing he'd do, he'd walk on the job, put his bag down, open it up, and off he went to the next bag of drains. And he'd come back and he'd just... And he'd come back again and $20 in there. See how it was. I was going for it. $20 back then was a lot of money, but... Or a good hit. It's like $100 these days. Or
good of a draw. That explains crap. I don't want
this. Well. Right. So it goes through all the external parts of a house. So it starts with the floor systems, right? So it has the lower level, then it goes up to all the other levels. So it tells you what the requirements are to adhere to whatever level of bushfire attack you need to meet. And it goes through all the external parts of the house. So floors, posts, columns, external walls. So with a low, there's no requirement. 12.5, any siding must have a flammability index of not more than 5. Timber or steel frame walls that use stock on the end of the... So it goes around and explains everything you need to do. So this is all the drafty or the architect, whoever's doing it, he'll use this to be able to take that big AL level and apply wherever's needed. Right? And it covers everything. So it gives you an idea if you know what area, what the requirements are, you have to do this. And for instance, one is once you get into higher levels, you can't use evap systems on the roof because of how combustible they are on the inside. Because inside they're either straw or paper. Did you know that?
The filters are filtered.
The filters are filtered. Yeah. Paper.
Yeah. Filter it just runs down it. Yeah. And absorbs
it looks like a filter because it's folded.
Yeah. So, and also they have to have all of them these days, regardless of the level, have to have a stealth clause in battle to stop any embers getting down there. Where one time it was only the high end units that used to have that, and it's just a flap when the air gets sucked through, drops down, it's on a spring, it closes. Not 100%, but it's better than not. Gets on about the roofing, what your requirements are for your roofing. Roof lights. I was working down at Dramana High School, which is in a high fire zone area, right? And it's been built over, it used to be a tech college, so part of it's been there since the year dot. They did an extension new building there when I was there about 5, 6, 7 years beforehand. And while I was there, building a new part when the government decided to give out these $2 million grants to every school or whatever it was, right? And just as they were getting finished, they brought in all this bushfire attack level. And they've come in, and they didn't have to touch the old school, right? Didn't matter what it was built out of, they didn't have to touch that. The newer building, they had to go around and seal all the penetrations and around everything with a fireproof coating. Over all the vents, they had to put a stainless steel mesh. They had to pull up decking and re-layer the decking to have a no more than a 3 mil gap, I think it was. Right? And then the newest part, which they hadn't even opened yet, the wood refused to give them a permit to open it until they changed all the glass, the timber cladding on the outside, and a few other things. Because it'd been built to a standard, but because it changed everything, the glass wasn't up to speed, they'd used the ply vertical, what do you call it, paneling on the outside.
That was approved.
Yeah.
It was good.
Uh-huh.
It shouldn't have been.
When they start the project, but these require, because it hadn't been finished at that time.
Yeah.
I don't know all the ins and outs, but all I know was what they were doing and what they had to do. But you know what the policy of the school was? First bell that went off, signed the fire, pack up the school and move it to, it was either Mornington or Frankston. Doesn't matter if the school burnt or not, the kids are gone, long gone. There is no insurance on public buildings or schools. So what's the bloody difference? Because I had to spend all this money on fireproofing then. Yeah. So you've got this bureaucracy that's ridiculous. So with the decking, tells you what you need to do. A fair bit on the decking. I've even seen people putting sprinkler systems on the roof in fireproof areas, high fire areas. Downside, great idea if you think about it. It's sprinkler system around all your fascias and gutters and whatever?
Or does he use polypipe?
Mm-hmm. See a problem there?
No, just a little one.
Melt?
It needs to be proper steel.
Yeah.
And it melts quicker than you think it would too, even though it's full of water.
Yeah, well, a lot of them I've seen are just a very thin gauge garden sprinkler type pipe.
Even a light grass pipe, it just goes.
Anybody ever been to a bushfire?
Yeah.
I drove into one, deliberately. No, we didn't. We got photos of it.
You're a worry, man. Why? You're a worry.
Is that thrill seeker tourism?
I was at Kilmore, and our friends, obviously Kilmore Fire, where the Kilmore fires were, and we drove down this back road to 10K, and it looked like a volcano was erupting over this hill. Like, it was just coming down crazy. We're about 800 metres away from it.
I helped fight one by nearly 20. And I vowed then I never wanted to see another one. And all I was doing was chasing the tail end with a bag, trying to put out, you know, from spreading and that, and you couldn't get anywhere near.
It rips the house apart, like, as it goes through. Like, we'll watch the house go up. It was like 5 minutes, man. It was like flashing.
Yeah. It's not nice. Now, did we cover wet areas?
We did a little.
We did a little bit of the assignment.
We've got our tables here to tell you where you need it, what you need to do. Okay. So if you've got it in doubt, use that table. But basically, it's as a minimum internal corner of a shower. All the internal corners of the showers are where it reaches the bottom, whether it's a tile base or a fiberglass base. The bottom, all indents, all fixings in that shower, the hob around the bath, 300 mil around the top of the bath, waterproof underneath the bath, timber floor, the whole of the floor, then up 50 mil. If it's a concrete slab, just the junction of the floor. You've got to have a water bar at the doorway so that can't travel through the tiles, through the substrate to the outside. Above a vanity, 300 mil. Again, that's the bare minimums. It's 300. 150, sorry, 150, not 300.
It says water resistant.
Yeah. And also says what proof? Not less than 150 mil. There's a difference between water resistant and waterproof. Water resistant is the product you're going to use underneath, and you need to coat them with waterproof or waterproof them somehow. Usually that's a membrane that you apply. Something like Lamy panel is waterproof. Glass is waterproof, so you don't necessarily have to use anything special underneath because you're putting that on top. Of course, it gives you little pictures of room height. There is a question there about room heights. Minimum room height is for a habitable area.
2 meters, isn't it?
Non-habitable 2.1. Non-habitable is 2.1. Okay? So you can have a ceiling with exposed beams. Inside that beam, so the ceiling part, 2.4, the beam protrudes down, it can be a 300 beam. You can get away with it. I think it's a 25%. There is information in there regarding it. Right? So that's how you get away with a 2.4 ceiling with beams hanging, exposed beams hanging down.
Why is it 2.1 in the kitchen?
2.1 is the kitchen because the kitchen's not a non-habitable area.
Okay.
Kitchen, bathroom, laundry, toilet, passageways are non-habitable areas.
Even though you're in them most of the time.
Yeah.
And just a question on that. When that comes back to ventilation, that's not required to be ventilated, a non-habitable area. We've got that thing in our thing, we've got a hallway.
No, it doesn't ventilate in.
So like can be artificial?
So you can have a wardrobe or an ensuite or whatever, with no windows, that's fine.
Okay. because it's not a habitable area.
You got a picture in your assignment where you've just got to fill in the details about minimum heights, and the other height is at a staircase.
2 meters.
2 meters. It's classed like a doorway.
Yeah.
So a door height is a minimum of 2 meters. Door is 2 or 4 low. So by the time you take your doorstop off, you make your allowances, it's sort of digging yourself up. But 2 meters is the minimum for a doorway. Alright. 2 meters for a staircase measured vertically from the nosing. So you draw a line through the nosing, the front of the stairs, diagonal line, and you measure vertically. So anything within that, travelling on that slope of the nosing, 2 meters. Okay. Every building must have a kitchen. In that kitchen,
there must be
a kitchen sink and facilities for the preparation and cooking of food.
So, a microwave.
Yeah. When all this was written, microwave wasn't invented. It's the kitchen sink part. And I'm pretty sure that you're only allowed one kitchen in a house.
Yeah, that's what they.
People see a lot of what I've seen too.
Yeah, you might get away with two under special conditions, but generally, one kitchen.
What about three? We had three.
Yeah. And you have three kitchens.
Yes.
So where you have a kitchen, and then you have a kitchen where you have to prepare. Butler's pantry is generally connected to the kitchen, so it's part of the kitchen. So, you know, there's... But you can have the kitchen, the second kitchen, but you can't have that sink. That's the crux of it.
So if you're making an outdoor one to go with your barbecue center, you're not really supposed to have a sink in it.
Yes, you can get away with an outdoor kitchen, but inside the kitchen. The reason I think it's there is to stop you from subletting part of your house. Right? Would you say that, Danny? The reason?
Yeah.
I think that's the reason.
That is bad wine.
What is?
But then you start getting the granny flats and that.
That's it's not even their business.
Hey?
It's your house. It's your land.
No, it's not their house. You keep thinking like that.
It's not your house.
Man. It's not your house. You might own it, you might pay for it, but it's not your house.
Yeah. Yeah.
They can take it whenever they like.
And you need at least one bath or shower. So it's, yeah, because usually, that's right. Usually they're they can be classed as relocatable.
Well, they're cool. I've only had a new one, but they've done it like
I built one years ago. It was a house I built. It got unsold, and some fluke, the new people came back to me to build the granny flat. And at the time, we couldn't put the kitchen in. But what I did was I put the kitchen in with everything except for a kitchen sink.
But you put the pipes in, so they just fit.
Yeah,
but
the pipes were in there, the gas was in there. Yeah. Bath or shower. So if you've got, you're building your own house, for instance, and you want to move in and it's not finished, all you need to do is finish one bathroom. The other one, you just get bored, whatever it happens to be, work in progress. As long as you've got one finished, we'll give you a CO board. We covered light and borrowed light and all that sort of stuff, didn't we? And the requirements for light, 10%, 5% ventilation.
Yep.
Oh, come on, I just changed up the batteries. I'm not going to cover that, you can read about it if you want. Sound insulation, your disco text. It tells you all about it, what you need to do. And it also gets on about different types of insulation. Cheers. With staircases, maximum of how many flight before a break?
15, 16, 18.
The maximum flight of stairs is 18. Once you get higher than, or what takes 18 in, you need a landing, a break.
Okay.
Maximum height of a rise?
Maximum height of a rise?
190. Minimum going? That's minimum trend? 240. Minimum, right? So, and that's measured from...
Got the table. There you go.
No. For the nosing.
So small.
You got your nosing, right? It's not measured from there to there.
We measured after the spawn.
It's measured from there.
Is that why my foot doesn't fit on the staircase?
Yeah, that you got a big foot.
No, normal foot. Ridiculous.
So that's 240. Okay. The maximum nose. There's a maximum nosing size. Did you know that? 30 mil.
Yeah.
All right. So that is your line of your nosing through there. So when you measure it, 2 meters to the ceiling. Handrails. What is the minimum height of a handrail? 900?
I'm
going to say 700. I love it when you
get it. It's different on the staircase.
Yeah, that's right. So on this one, what is the height of that one?
It was close. It was like a
step. Barriers and handrails. Hang on, I'm getting there.
Minimum or maximum? Minimum?
990.
You're 65.
I am.
865 according to this, yeah.
What's the minimum gap?
125.
125, so a sphere. Exactly. Because if the head can go through, the rest of them can go through. That's the theory, right? So it's 125 between there, right? And that has to be a clear handrail these days, uninterrupted. You can't have rocks or something where your hands are going to fit. You've got to have a clear run. Okay? What about when you get the top of the stairs? What's the height, minimum height of the handrail?
1 meter.
1 meter.
You're reading this, aren't you?
You read that one, didn't you?
I've got that.
We're there.
Yeah, and you didn't guess it. You would have got to guess it wrong. You've actually got a little bit of a transition space at the top, so to allow for that change. But basically, 865, a meter, 240, 190, them are the numbers you need to.
And this is a...
Spiral.
What's a spiral?
What's a spiral?
Oh, it's spiral staircase. Oh, sorry. Yeah. I'll say that one.
Now, when you do decks in that outside, when do you need a handrail around the deck or the veranda or wherever it is?
If it's over...
1.2 metres, isn't it? Above? It's a metre.
It's over a metre?
Yeah, 1 metre. Yeah.
So, you've got the house there. You've got the door. That's ground height. And you're putting a deck on, right? And that's... 1010, you need handrail.
Or you need to put some tiles on the bottom.
Or you build some soil up there.
Yeah, heat the soil.
Or it's $9.99. Right? That's the cheapest and easiest way. So you're selling it to the client. We either put a handrail on, cost you money, I've got to allow for it, or we do this, I don't allow for a handrail, and then you can either get me to put it on when the job's finished, you get in easier, or you can build it yourself. Or you don't put it on at all and you save yourself a coin. All right?
Okay.
So that's the easiest way for that one. And with stairs, if they're not right, don't try fixing them. Pull them out, throw them away and start again. Because you cannot fix a staircase that's not right. With the all them
springers.
Risers have to be the same. I think you get away with 1 or 2 mil in the tolerances. But if you've ever walked upstairs and you keep kicking one, I think it's once you get past about 4 or 5 rise, your brain actually kicks in and it starts doing the job for you. So if you've ever kicked one or felt like, oh, I missed that one, it's because the rise are usually not the same size. Yeah. And it becomes an OHS problem. So one of the things the building inspector will check is your stairs and your staircase and your steps for anything more than the 190 or less than 240. Because if they sign off on that job, give you a C of O and it's wrong, somebody has an accident on that and hits the insurance company for a public liability, and it's not right, they're going to come back to building surveyor for not doing his job properly. Right? So that's one of the thing areas that they have to check on.
Is there regulations that stair treads have to have group on
nowadays? Yes.
Yeah, it's actually yes. changing at the moment.
would that include carpet stairs?
Yeah, you can have carpet stairs. It's actually changing at the moment too.
What changes the length of carpet stairs?
Staircase or metal tread. It's got to have this like a stain on it that is slip resistant plus the Velcro strip that clients can rip off after.
So on your beautiful
and
home, you're
going to get the groove plus that normally.
The Velcro strip goes on a...
It's like $700 or something in retail. It's just like a little Velcro strip.
Like a lot of kind of wooden stairs and stuff like that.
Yeah, and it's horrible.
Well, that'll not come in until the next NCC.
Yeah, so May 1st next year.
Not only going to be the 3 year block. Yeah, they're not. The changes to the NCC are going to be every 3 years. Yeah, the last one I use, it's like a gritty sandpaper type thing. Comes in a 50mm strip in a ball, where it's self-adhesive backing, and you put that on the front of the tray.
How ugly.
Well, you rip it off after.
It's like anything, what you do after the ball. One of the things you've got to be careful with the staircases and carpets is making the allowance for the transition. If you've gone from tiles or timber floor to bare boards and then you've got carpet at the top, you've got to make that allowance at the top. Otherwise...
I've been looking at a few houses recently and I've been using MDF, the standard MDF for the stringer boards.
Yeah.
Is that...
Yeah, well, the cheaper... if you're covering a carpet in stair... In, covering a stair... Staircase in carpet, MDF. Yeah, that's all. 35, 45 mil.
Yeah, it's 32 or 35 mil.
Yeah, they'll do the stringers, the risers, the treads, everything in it.
Well, one little bit of water damage to it, the whole thing's gone.
Don't get it wet. If you get wet around a staircase, well,
something
you're going to be a problem anyway.
Yeah, but no, you have some wild parties. And
wild parties.
Yeah, if you're painting it, MDF. Especially if you're painting it.
Just don't sand it.
Anything more than 3570. Gets on about the sill of a threshold or a door opens onto a stairway. So anything over 570, you've got to have a transition period, you've got to have a bit of a landing.
Instead of a door opens directly out on the stairs?
Yeah. So if it's over 570 on the other side, you need that landing.
Yeah. So you're saying it's under 570 it should pass?
Yeah, you don't need a landing. Where is it?
What I just told before.
Yeah. Have I?
Maybe.
Okay. So that's three rise.
Yeah, because it's bifold doors that open out on the set of stairs.
Yeah.
And it got knocked back because there was no landing.
Right.
But it's only two steps. It's only about like 350 high.
Landings must be not less than 750 long, and where this involved, the change in direction. The length is measured 500 meters out of the be provided where the sill at a threshold of a door opens onto a stair that provides a change in floor level or floor to ground level greater than 3 rises or 5 7 mil. T, figure 3, name 1 5. That's fine. 3.
No, you need 3 rises.
3, 7, 1, 5.
Good gun. One more. Oops, right. too much.
Right, it's gone crazy.
That's it.
There you go. Landing not required, one on the left.
So maximum 3 rises. Mm-hmm. So it's got 3 rises.
Fine.
So it doesn't need a landing.
So it doesn't need a landing.
So you have the NCC ready on that page, and you say, well, what about this, mate?
It's my new pants.
I'll try it out.
You just get your ID. You think you're on something else.
He'll take your name, dude.
Troublemaker.
Hey.
Don't turn up in the building commission for another 5 years. Do not ask go.
So maximum 3 rises.
So this goes through all the handrails requirements. It changes on swimming pools for fencing. Right? So that 125 mil gap for a handrail for ballasters and that, when you're talking about swimming pools drop down to 100 mil. And the height of the handrail turns into 1200. And the latch has to be 1500. And the gate has to open out over. Because the theory is if they get under it and they open it, the weight of them can open that gate. Right? And the change in, again, I haven't seen what they've got in here when we get to it.
You're going wrong.
Hang on, swing pull now.
394.
Yeah.
And the 165, 125. Yeah. Got nothing in there. All right. You'd have to have
the standard, yeah.
Yeah, standard. But basically, it's just changed a little bit again. At one time, you used to be able to have the house. We'll see the swimming pool was there. And you could put a fence around it. So you had your door or something here, right? As long as you had the required self-closing mechanisms on there, that was fine. Now you need a secondary area.
What?
So that stays just as your normal door, and then your gear goes in there.
Oh God.
So what about if your back of your house opens onto the pool?
You can legit. If it was past previous, it's legit. New regs state it has to have this buffer so that you step outside and that gate opens.
So you can't have your bifold doors open up to your pool.
No.
He's doing the great long
any
run.
Any window
that
you've got in there
door.
Can only open a maximum of 100 mil. So you've got to do something to stop the window opening more than 100 mil, whether it's reduce the winder, put a block on it, stop that 100 mil, okay? Any other gate that's on there has to be open, right? Open out over. Now, my last house I had an indoor swimming pool, I told you about it. You don't need that on an indoor swimming pool. You can open straight from one area onto the other.
As long as it's inside.
Yeah,
okay.
But you still need the self-closing mechanisms for that. And if you've got a sliding door, patio door, it's not that easy to get a cheap system that will close that door every time.
They're awful, those systems.
Usually the self-closing mechanism costs as much as the door. Roughly about $1,000. Okay? Be aware of it. I did one for a mate of mine, and he had, there were 2340 full height patio doors, but they're only small panels, they're a stacker door. And we tried everything available to try and get them doors, and what happens is they tend to become top heavy, so they might move the top and not the bottom. And it ended up, you have to get special systems in to be able to close them properly. Okay? And it was about $1,000 a panel. Where were mine? I just got the timber fly screen door, nice and light, filled in the bottom with Perspex, had me mesh on the top, and just a simple closer. Good as good. Whether that was past these years or not remains to be seen, but. Put it on the flywire doors, on the aluminium doors, and a security door on there, and I put the self closer on that rather than on the glass door, because the glass door is a hell of a lot heavier. And I got away with simple systems.
Eric?
Yeah. No, I've got mine, thanks. So you got your wind regions. We're in category, got to get the right category 3. Yeah, category 3 area for us. I don't think we need to go through earthquakes. Huh. Get one in, build a house through it.
Oh, in Newcastle.
That's pretty well much of it for the NCC. Oh, energy. Six star. The requirements for six star these years. Again, there's brochures you can get from.
There's really good practice note from the BBA about how just balance.
Yep, and it tells you all the requirements. So I think I've said here in the past, if you're doing an extension renovation, if it's less than 50%, you don't have to bring the existing house up to six star. If it's over 50%, you're increasing the size of the house. You've got to bring, or you may have to bring the existing house up to six star. It's up to the building surveyor how hard it is, whether it's worth it or not. But in a new build, has to be six star, right?
It's gonna have a rainwater tank, how about that?
Or you either have to have either or rainwater tank or solar hot water. Or recycled water. That takes the place of the rainwater tank. So then a lot of the newer estates have recycled water.
Yep.
Which then is you've got to have both here.
Both here?
You've got to have both the rainwater tank and the solar hot water system there.
Right. The newie?
It just says you require a new class 1 building, also require the rainwater, and 2, the solar water.
Uh-huh.
It doesn't say all, anyway.
Oh,
you've got to
have your, you've got to have, if you have the rainwater tank.
Oh, no, it does, yeah, no, it's all, you're correct, it does have an or in it, you just can't see it.
Oh, yeah.
Sorry, but.
Have you need the rainwater tank? Or, see the or? That's what I've got to put up with. Or.
The bookworm.
Yeah.
They're actually building 7 star in Waller, they've built a couple.
Oh, I know, they just read.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're going to get the 10 star.
Yeah, I think we're 10 star. Behind on that area.
Yeah. If you go to Canada or somewhere like that, 10 star. I think they're up for about 10 star.
What I was watching last night. Yeah, Canada.
Canada. This old house.
Yeah,
that series right there. The insulation was like that thing, solid foam.
Yeah,
and then the insulation.
Europe's just, yeah. For what they've got to do in Europe. That's a brilliant one of the floor system. The concrete slab down, the build walls up to a height.
You actually got to get specialists.
And then they build the walls on top of that. And what they do is they have a bit like a big concrete paver. So they've got these like sleeper walls, and they layer these panels on top, and then they put a screed over the top of that. So they're getting that subfloor void as a buffer, like a vacuum flask. But then they put their heating on top of these concrete panels, and then they put a screed on top of that. So they're getting heating and the thermal efficiency and all that.
Where did you say this, sorry?
Grand Designs.
Yeah, Grand Designs. I see it quite often now.
Yeah.
One of the best programs to watch that for picking up bits and pieces. And if you look even closer at them, you think, geez, that's rough, that finish.
Yeah.
because you wanted a bit of ventilation in there to get rid of the door. It defeats the purpose of putting a seal on the bottom of the door.
Should have actually seen one of those.
Normally they're on the plans, but you leave them on. I've seen some.
Well, I don't reckon it comes under it because it's got a seal on it. It comes around the edges.
So there's a lot of information in there about it, about lights. These days, with lights, it's all LEDs. You've got a maximum wattage per square meter that you can have in a room. Five. 5 kilowatt hours per square meter. So the way I put it across, you've got the typical bedroom of 3x3, 9 square meters. We used to stick a 60-watt bulb in there. If it wasn't big enough, we'd put a 75-watt in. Well, 3x3 is 9. 9 times 5, 45 watts is the maximum you can put in a room these days. So the old Edison screw or whatever it happened to be, the old-fashioned lights are gone. But with LEDs, you've got more light with less power usage. All right? So it's 5... kilowatts per square meter.
You're actually even supposed to have a timer on the lighting, on corridor lighting.
Yeah.
That
would be
a sensor,
isn't it? Oh, that just adds up to the point score of your energy rating.
It comes into the 6-star.
Put a sensor on it and job done. You only have to set it does it automatically. And most sensors will have a sensor for you know it's daytime and nighttime.
Right. Here is the makeup of your wall. A weatherboard wall has a 0.48 rating by itself, just plaster framing and weatherboards, right? 5 is spent for 0.42. You would think a brick wall would have a hell of a lot more. 0.56. So from 0.48 to 0.56. 0.08 of an R rating different. I remember when they start bringing the star rating system in, we go to all these seminars, and originally at the time it was going to be rainwater tank and solar hot water panels. And they were saying it was going to put about $1,500 on the price of a house. And I actually stood up and I said, excuse me, but that's bullshit. $1,500 for a water tank and solar hot water panels, putting $1,500 on? I don't think so. I basically got shouted down. And then as time went by, they tweaked it to see one or the other. Well, it's still going to cost you more than $1,500.
That's like $1,500.
Yeah. And then you've got to get it on there and all the connections and whatever. Anyway, but with the walls, that was the other thing. Got on about the floor, because it's all timber floors at the time. And I said about double thickness, you put a chipboard floor down and then you put an overlay floor on top, whether it's 19, and they said, no, timber floor has next to no thermal properties. got on about carpet, and that was shouted down as well, next to no thermal properties. And at the time there wasn't anything in the calculations about, this is all computer calculation. Now, I don't know. So, goes on about all the different types of walls, the R ratings that you have. Insulation of a slab. Depending on the type of heating you do on a slab, you need to think about that. If you're doing a slab with in slab heating, you need to be conscious of what's underneath, where the water table is. What they found out with hydronic heating is, it was drawing the heat from the slab into the ground, and it was actually drawing the moisture up. So what they've had to start doing with hydronic is putting in insulation, a thin layer of polystyrene in between.
That's a silver one, you can run the tube. Yeah. Is that the right one?
Well, it's just a pipe system that
it's
runs.
Already got the cutouts in it.
If you've got a waffle slab, that's already got that, right?
Yeah, that's right. There's different systems for it. It's basically a pipe system that goes under the reel, and you pour hot water through it, and it just heats. Similar to an electric one.
It's like that, so the constant is
That's your gears in, if you ever want to work that one out. It's better than electric.
Yeah.
It's a similar system to that. It's just cheaper to run, and it's quicker to react.
It's a pain wheel meter and everything now, there's a change of meters and stuff like that. And you go on solar, which we've had this issue now a couple of times, so solar got to a second contact grid. So that can't run at a certain time, it's a little over what it's made. Good problem, but I have to find it.
Too much juice coming through.
And the load and it throws the wiring in. Yeah, we're looking at the cost of that.
Brother was telling me a story of when he was near Blue School, one of the wet areas, light, anybody's happy with what you think at all?
I think we're too early to go.
Like I said, you've got time once you sit down and start doing it, get stuck with
it. Question the first assignment, the question 11 word.
Oh, yeah.
Where does it list all these things?
Can't find
it. Plans now, I've had a look at all the plans, none of them have any of that on it. It's pretty much on your site plan, yeah?
Yeah,
like your VAL, wind type, flat area, earthquake, alpine, whatever.
Oh, right. I've been having trouble looking for those for about half an hour. Design drawings, this is question 11. The design drawings for the project we work with. I'm going to go through the second assessment now. Because the first one covered everything.
So,
it gives you a scenario. I'm not going to read it. So you've got the scenario of the Gulf where you're the builder and you're going to give advice to a priest and a solicitor.
Yeah.
Right? And the first one is to do with classification building. You've got to classify what, the accountant was wondering what type of building classification the building currently has as it now houses his practice, which is, I think we touched on this in the early days. Volume 1 of the MCC has the classification for all 10 buildings. Right? Volume 2 only covers class 1 and class 10. So you need to go to this here.
A3.2.
Just pull that one up and find out which one matches up to any. What is it? It's a practice, it's an office.
Class 5. We've done these, you know that.
Yeah,
we went through
that one again. So you're quoting NCC Volume 1, or is it 3? A3.2. And you see it, it's a class, whatever, and give it a bit of a spiel of what it is. Nice and easy. Then he wants to know, again, classification. What advice can you give him about this process? Hang on. What's the re-established fish and chip shop? So what class is a fish and chip shop? What class is a resident chop shop? Two separate classifications.
6 and 4.
Yeah. He's going to renovate upstairs living with his mom, blah, blah, blah. What advice can you give him about this process? And what are you going to tell him? This will come, should come back a bit from legislation. What advice can you tell him about it?
Which question is
it? Number, the second one.
Question two.
The real issue is that the accountant is sick of. Go back to fish and chip shop. What advice can you give somebody about changing from one classification to another?
Well, the first thing I have to do is go to the town planning section and municipal council.
He has to apply for reclassification permit. Basically, yeah, because you're changing classification. Next one asks you about multiple classification. So if you're looking again at volume two, volume one, and the reason people, the next one, low rise commercial, why we cover it is because domestic builder generally does class one and class 10, but you have other types of residences, two, three, and four, which they can do. It just depends on what's connected to them. So what is connected to them dictates if they can actually do it or not. And the other thing is your insurance, whether your insurance company will let you do it. So if you want to do units, for instance, townhouses or retirement village or something like that, potential to do it, you need to check firstly with your insurance company whether they'll accept the liability of doing them. And then once you've got that, basically it's just a sign off with the building surveyor. Okay. Multiple classifications was to, let's see, end of this one.
3.3, eh?
Yeah. Where parts have different purposes. One's a 4, one's a 6, or wherever it's 5 and 6, wherever it has to be. There's not one. The provisions of 1 do not apply when the minor use is a laboratory or class 2, 3, or 4. If a building has parts of different classifications, each part must comply with all the relevant provisions for its classification.
So if it's
where is it? It was a
6 and a 4.
Yeah.
So what the first part saying is if you 10% of the floor is the major part,
yeah,
then you have to, the whole lot has to comply with those rules.
Yes. The highest. Highest one. Yeah.
No.
What a final volume one?
No, because this
doesn't give you definites, it gives you what you can't do rather than what you can do, which it asks about to be. Now the next one gets on about counting the single new product on the market. In fact, it's written by the flag wave, blah, blah, blah. Can you use this item?
Alternate solution.
Yeah. If so, what processes will you have to go through? Which tells you NCC, page 16, 17, I think it is.
Volume.
It's 0.7,
0.8. 0.8, 0.
Well, you question is 16, 17,
the
alternate
solution.
That's right. So it has to match up with the performance requirements or go through expert judgment. It's one that goes around in circles. Alternative
assessment
solution,
methods,
performance requirements, chicken and the egg. Which comes first? And the type of assessment methods that can be used for an alternate solution? No.
before you get to the car.
No.
For assessment methods.
The manufacturer might have an engineer certify it.
Yeah, that's issue. Right. You need certification from relevant expertise.
Evidence to support the use.
Yeah, evidence to support it. It's in there.
A 0.9.
A 0.9, I think it
yeah,
is.
That's correct.
It's a really good the VBA as well.
Yeah, it's just come out. It's brand spanking new on about alternative solutions. Because it never used to come into play.
Yeah, maybe not just on cladding systems. So there's one of them.
Yeah, it never used to come. You've got too much time on your
arm. Hey, James.
I know where they are. I know what they are. I just haven't got the time to read them. Yeah, in times gone by, the alternate solutions didn't really come into play. But now, because all the new technologies and everything that's coming in, it's becoming more and more popular. And there's actually specialists out there, so if there's a new product comes out and you want to use it, they will get the evidence for you, and they will get it all. It's cost, but it's easier than you trying to do it.
Thank you, everybody.
Tells you that the board has a fire rating of 0010. I ask you to explain what each of these figures means. What you're explaining: structural adequacy, integrity, and integration. Now,
excuse me.
If you look on your CD. I don't know what it's called these days. It was called Student Resources or something like that.
Course notes.
Course notes? Right. If you read that, you will find paragraphs on all of these. So underneath the sections.
Sorry, what was that, Anna?
That's just a question.
Course notes. As soon as you heard answers, you quickly.
Yeah, the answers.
Like I said, one time you used to get a hard copy, so I could reference pages or whatever. Yeah, I'm going to look now. I'm going to have to read it and go through. Look at the index. So it's got a lot of information. Every subject has one, and it's specific to that subject. It also, if you go to the very end of each section, end of the book. You've got examples. So when it comes to pull forward sheets or variation notices or whatever, there's an actual example at the back to give you a bricks and mortar idea. Okay. You need to read it.
Is that how you're going to get a straight answer in the back?
No, the examples in the back. Examples of
in the
answer.
End of the book.
Yeah.
I'll be saying it.
Okay. Yeah, I'll never find it. See what went one.
See 1.1. Page 87.
Types of construction required.
Right. You remember me telling me about the three classifications of building, A, B, and C, for the fire
resistance
level?
Worst
A being the highest.
Best or worst,
yeah. Okay. Table in here. Page 87, Z1.1, it tells you, single story, no matter what class it is, it's a type C. Two story, if it's a 2, 3 or 9, it's a B, 5, 6, 7, 8, it's a C. What classification have we got for the fish and chip shop in the office and that? Four and six.
Four in on there, isn't it? Yeah, there's a reason why.
No, because you go underneath, yeah, that's it.
Yep, there.
A class 4 building up
here
at the top of the story, isn't it? And you've got to read that. It basically comes under a class 1. And class 6, 2-story, it's a C. Right, so everything we're working with is a C. And the DBU, residential, all you can do is a type C building. That's where it gets you. Anything that's outside the C, you can't do. Anything more than, always get the two or the three stories mixed up.
Two stories.
You can't do that. Anything more than 2,000 square meters floor area, you can't do that. So that's where your parameters of the DBU. All right? So what do we have to do?
There's a bit more to that class 4 on the top story thing. We just give you one or two more paragraphs. 1.3.
I just want to see what. That one?
C1.3B1. When a class 4 part occupies the whole top story, the classification becomes what? The story for the story underneath it.
Right.
Yeah. So
in
that's
a building in a class 4 part of the top story, the focus of a class B part to the top story must be
the
next higher story.
That's right. If the teacher understands.
So it's the same as one below.
Yeah.
Still, it's type C. We can't do type C, the one below.
No, you can't do it.
Because
it's a building, yeah, it's a
outside your
classification.
We can't have DBU, you can't build that top story. Yes.
You can do the top one.
If your mate builds the bottom one.
Yes. So you get somebody else to build the bottom
one. Yeah. Right.
And then when there's a car park involved,
no.
You can do the car park.
Yeah. Because
yeah.
What's the difference between a car park and a garage?
More cars than
well, a garage on a DB, on a ready, you can have a 10-star car garage on a house because it's still a class 10. But as soon as it gets linked to anything other than a class 1 and it tips more than three cars
yeah.
It becomes a class 7. And then as soon as you stick storage in it, a cage or anything like that, it becomes a 7B. Again, because then you might store chemicals, whatever.
Keep going further on that. I was looking at fire ratings for the thing, and depending on which side you're facing the garage, the door in between, it's got different fire ratings from both sides.
Yeah.
Is that, how does that work?
Don't know.
It's like it's 90 minutes from one side.
Commercial, I don't need to know it. I don't want to know it. My brother's an electrician. I don't need to know about electrical work. I still got to hire another electrician to do me work, right? But why I'm not a fan of the commercial side of it. I'm a domestic builder. Give me questions on domestic.
So there is a commercial course as well, isn't there?
It becomes a diploma.
No.
When you do the diploma, it's all wrapped around commercial work. But low rise commercial.
More assignments.
A lot more. If you do decide to go on to do a diploma or thinking about it, it's a different type of course to this. This is just sort of questions and answers. The next one is report writing. Everything is a lot of writing. Every question, every answer. You've got to do a lot of research. It's a year and a half, 2 year course. It's a hell of a lot bigger than this. A lot more in depth.
Yeah. It's so fun.
I wouldn't know, I've never done it, I don't want to do it. I have no intentions of becoming anything to do with commercial. Just the thought of unions puts me off.
Oh, scum that. I mean,
you're from the country, America.
The accountant has heard that this order so that it can be used for a type A construction. Again, what this type of construction is, so this is the highest, lowest, middle ground, type A is the highest. Give an example. Yeah. Describe what is meant by type B and type C. And is the accountant's assessment of the product correct?
To a limited degree, yes, it is correct. Because it can be used on an external wall that's non-load bearing at a certain distance from a fire source. But that's the only place it can be used.
Basically, nowhere. We'll just say.
Well, they can't because Taipan is high fire, high resistance, yeah. So you can't use it.
Forget it. A much higher fire rate.
Yeah, but that's what it says.
If you look up the thing, it says an external long load wearing wall, 0000000 Taipan construction.
The local priest hears you are good at this stuff. Rings ask which class of building is churches. So again, it's back to the classification. The church. Church is a meeting place, isn't it?
Yeah.
Is it the same as a theatre or anything like that?
No. Sounds
about right. And then the shop next to it.
It's a six.
Six.
It's because you're not too far.
Five. Oh, yeah.
Alright, the priest places of the church is a congregation of 12. The church itself consists of a local CFA captain, a divine team. That consideration should be given to both active and passive fire control elements. Can you explain? So you just got to give a little spiel on what active and passive is. So active is something that actually does something, it's the sprinklers, the fire alarm. The hydrants, the hoses, smoke detectors, all that sort of stuff. That's active. Passive is what the building is basically made out of. It's structure, fire resistant material. Now, this next one's the one everybody hears.
Which one's that?
Even more concerned by your explanation, the priest hires you to do a building audit of the church. You have to prepare a check sheet of what you would be looking for. So again, it's basically a list, a tick and a flick list of a yes or a no, what you were looking for regarding the fire requirements. Create this checklist by referring to the relevant sections of the NCC that are applicable to this type of building. So look at the type of building, what the fire requirements are, and you're looking for active and passive fire requirements. Does it come up to the speed? Yes, no comments. So it's a simple list down one side of what you're looking for, a yes and a no, and a comment. There's your audit done. Okay, it's blank. So you're not filling it in, you're just listing the elements you're looking for. Just to see them as a site order before you start building or doing anything. So you're going to use table 5, the type C construction, FRL, building elements, volume 1, section C, fire resistance, the active fire control requirements, volume 1, section E, service and equipment. You'll find the information that you need to include the audit in then two parts. So part A is fire hydrants, fire hose, sprinklers, portable fire extinguishers. Are they required in this type of building? So you might have you're gonna have to have a spiel for the type of building it is, and the type E, type B, type C. And that way it follows on.
We've got enough information in there.
In where?
Well, a lot of these depend on the building height, and if this church's got a big spire on it.
Yeah, but it's not a story. Huh? Not be a story. Just see it's a single story.
We called it a 9B, I think.
Yeah. It's a 9B, but it's a single story.
Single story number.
It's open to the rafters. Building is this?
Well, it just changes everything.
Will this car park have an effect on the ability to complete the job?
Oh, yes.
Because the underground car park's below ground level, it's still two stories on high.
I'm actually going to show you a letter.
but it's commercial.
Because I asked a question.
Is there any legislation on the ground car parks anywhere?
Yeah. Well, there's a fair bit in the antics, they are.
Volume 2 or?
Volume 1.
Whereabouts?
C1.2 and spec C1.15.
C1.2.
A3.2. C1.2, I think, just points out that it doesn't become a three story building. Spec C1.1.5.
Need that make it any bigger? Or is that big enough?
Yeah, that's fine.
There's no mention of the amount of stories that a domestic builder is limited to. This has been confirmed by the VB. The Master Builders Association. Civil terms, domestic builder anything to do with the form. Theoretically and realistically, they are able to build commercial buildings such as those that fall within the class 2 and 4 usage defined at the very least. With regard to the former, apartments being homes as per a 4th definition example, the real issue is this instance is when a car park requirements move from a private garage as defined in the volume 2 of the National Construction Board. In this document, a private garage means... Obviously, any car park facility that falls out of the definition above may be deemed a Class 7A car park, as defined in Volume 1 of the National Construction Code, and therefore being commercial building falls outside the range of a domestic builder.
So therefore, Class 7A is an underground car park?
Yeah.
So which falls outside our jurisdiction?
Right.
But, there's more? No. Right. So it's in black and white. Mm-hmm.
I asked the question because I scoured the building regs, the act, and everything, looking for a definitive, and it doesn't give you one.
Yeah. It's hard to find a spending house.
Even defined class 2, 3, and 4, and the only thing I've come up with was basically that it's a residence. A residence is the same as a home, and the classification, the home is a class, you know, is class 1 in the realms of a DBU.
Even in this thing here, it could be argued that the car park belongs to the residents above and has nothing to do with the fish and chip shop.
Yeah, but it's that once you start getting over more than three car parks in it.
Except in that, which says. Oh, no, it actually has to be attached to a car park building, yeah.
Yeah.
So have any number of cars in that one. Yeah.
What defines it as a car park, though? If you have a large open floor landing area and then just section off three as car parks.
Yeah, well, what's the rest of it then?
Storage.
No,
well,
that's 7B. That's right, it's commercial again.
Basketball court.
Bedroom.
Ah,
yeah. Let's get someone else to build it.
Yeah. So how do you get
it? Would be a hell of a lot easier if it was infinite, simple, and simple four blackouts.
Double size.
Eh?
Make the car parks double size.
Ah, but there's a thing that gives you a size of a car park.
My mum is still working on it.
Yeah, the amount of people that fuck that up.
Stop trying to be awkward. I didn't write the bloody thing.
No,
I don't see I agree with it.
Don't get around it.
Yeah. I just have to mark your assignment. The car park is an underground basement. Is in an underground basement. Your scope of domestic building, domestic construction. As long as you're building a residence, there is no limit to the amount of stories you are able to construct. As the building covers six buildings, it becomes a commercial job, which you are not registered to do.
Could you just contract that one part of the
possibly?
Well, you've got to do that with the fish and chip shop anyway, so
possibly.
Mm.
It appears to me.
Priest calls back. He has decided to rip down his presbytery and have you build a new one. There's a mutual wall with the church. Yeah. Classification. Prepare a report. What's a report?
Thank you, Bobby.
Yeah, it's a bit of writing. Three paragraphs. Paragraph, you may ask.
10 lines? Four lines?
Well, lines are both graphic. In between and another one. Prepare a report for the priest on your official business documentation. Okay? Or inventor, bill, head, company logo, whatever it wants.
Sorry. Can we step back a little? The call before that, number 9.
Did I miss it?
The press read, what was it classified as?
Yeah. Like, we went down. Yeah.
Four. I reckon it's a class 3. Because you've got an itinerant. You've got itinerant people, like the priest doesn't own it. He's coming and going, he might be there for a year, he might be there for 5 years.
But... Yeah, but still permanent.
Is that permanent?
He might be there for the duration of.
Long term, or yeah, class 3 is for long term or transient living of unrelated people. So it might be the police, priest, or some of the clergy living in there.
Let's have a look.
Yeah. So you said that,
like, the men of the
club. You know, you didn't know. Do you study like everything?
Not like you're about churches.
Yeah, because the church is already a class. A 9, so therefore it's going to be a dwelling that's inside a, that makes it a 4, which is inside a 9. That's how we read it, isn't it?
Well, it's not inside, it's separated from the church by a wall, so it's not so
bad.
Please
call back, yes, it's sacred down to the ground. What fascination is it? Alright, you need to find out what the definition of a rectory is.
What?
No, he said to pull down his presbytery.
Presbytery is a rectory.
Oh, sorry, same as a rectory. Okay, yeah.
All right. Find out the definition of a presbytery. Right.
Which is...
The home of one or more Roman Catholic priests.
That's right. There you go.
Wikipedia.
And the Google says it's a body of church elders and ministers.
So there could be a whole... Horde isn't living in there.
Just the one priest.
He's got a whole truffle of them in there.
One priest made ten playboys.
That's not, that's not very important. Keep that for tomorrow.
So basically we're talking like a penitentiary.
But the other thing that got it for me is like, because this presbytery is not actually inside the church, it's a different building.
Separate building.
And that's why I went with class 3 instead of a class 4.
I'm just coming to school.
Okay. A resident of another building of class 1 or 2, which is common for the long term or transient living, for a number of unrelated persons. Right? And then class 4, a dwelling in a building.
The key is inside, in a building.
Yeah.
And it's not inside the church.
Connected to it, isn't it?
But it hasn't got a door through it, it's got a solid wall.
And yeah, but
would you want to be connected straight into the church?
Presbytery possibly could have.
It will have a door into the church.
Doesn't want the priest getting wet.
So none of those in class 3 matches.
Hey, who's he using the back doors?
Here we go. Here we go.
Well, they are, aren't they?
Well, well, they come from the back.
The front door's for visitors.
They come back from the, they come in from the back door. That's always.
It's not a quad one. Yeah. You might pick it up the wrong way.
It's not town planning. That's obviously the family planning.
Right. You've got to prepare a report on your official business documentation detailing him, the legislative and planning requirements, environmental standards, and safe work practices that you believe will be necessary to consider prior to, during, and after demolition of a presbytery. So, you do. You can use That is a helping hand. Australian standards for demolition. Okay. I think I can hear it.
No.
No.
You give me those.
Yeah, you can get it.
You can. While you're there, give me the rest of them.
So it goes through and
yeah.
That'll help you. Legislation, it's basically you need to cover town planning, requirements, applications, building permits, forms 3 and 4, demolition permits, separation.
What's from demolition, AS?
AS. 2601.
Asbestos removal.
Yeah, well, hazardous substances, separation, protection of the public, EPA, working times, you need to cover all that. Right?
Two paragraphs. Need like more like another page to cover that.
Report should include prior to demolition, obtaining necessary requirements, salvage list, you know, what you're going to recycle, what you're not going to recycle, what you can. Any structural engineers that might need to be engaged. We explained that one in low-rise commercial, why you get a structural engineer. Site survey, possibly, maybe, depending. Hazardous materials, services, underground services, out before you dig, all that sort of stuff. Notifications to adjoining properties, applications for road closures, underground services that have to be affected, all that sort of stuff. The firefighting equipment that's needed for demolition.
Oh, really?
Noise, dust, security. Forms 3 and Forms 4, protection regarding possible damage. Um,
Any forms, documentation required? Section 29 of the Building Act, Council consent. And then it goes through all the forms that's needed. Typically, for a build, you need the same forms plus demolition. What else? But this is a biggish question, this one.
It doesn't need to be that comprehensive, it looks.
Yeah. Cover as much as you think. Alright? As long as you give me the gist of it. The priest has also asked what other industry professionals he needs to consult. So who would you consult with?
Oh. Engineers. Surveyors.
A little tip for you, that question is going to come up in the next one as well, where you've got to explain who you would consult with, so keep it so you can cut and paste into the next one twice.
Quantity surveyors.
Yeah. Architects, draftspersons, engineers, quantity surveyors,
planning department.
Any industry professionals that you think of.
Building surveyor.
And the one you're asking about.
Yeah.
Design drawings for the presbytery were completed by, and you are sure of this competency. You just have to check the drawings. Where would you find information regarding the Bay Area, earthquake, wind type, alpine environment, flood area, termite area? Yeah. Basically on your rock plan, your site plan, because it's information outside of the build. Right?
Yeah, just all the site plan.
Yeah.
It's the same for all of them.
Basically, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You might find it elsewhere on the plan, especially your BEL.
Because, yeah, it's going to be under.
But all the other stuff, termite area, you might find in slab footing details as well as. But generally, you're going to find all of that on your block plan, your site plan, because it's associated outside of the actual building. It's a very ambiguous, open question. Yeah. Where and how can this information be obtained from the building designer to include in his design drawings? Explain your answer. Any idea where you get all this information from?
Council.
Yeah, local council. They know if they're in an earthquake. They know what wind zone they're in. It don't change.
The NCC's got good descriptions of each one as well. Both are like broad
yeah.
things.
Well, it's a bigger picture, but yeah, it counts more specific. There's actually a form that you can fill in, and it's in the building regs. It's a form, section 326. It's a request for building property information.
Like all the council websites have that as well. Mm-hmm. Just click on it and fill it out and pay your $29.
Usually all of the relevant forms that you need are available to the council offices, not online. Yeah. Everything's there, everything is there.
Except the Protection Works ones.
No, you've got to fill in yourself.
Why haven't they got a standard forms? Every council, I've looked at a few councils, everyone's different. All the forms are different. And it's ridiculous.
It's bureaucracy. You've got to justify your job in there, man.
Oh, Jesus. The protection one's got one form, the other guy's got two forms, the other one's got three forms.
Yes. And the final one, who requires a copy of this document prior to granting a building permit?
Council.
Doing Neely. Yeah, the relevant. RBS.
We should finish that one tomorrow. Tomorrow night, because we've got to school. Just drink at home, it doesn't matter, fresh drinks.
All right, drop it back to this first one. Pass three. Your checklist, quality assurance checklist. Read the document checklist of details and necessary information to be included in the contract work and drawing.
Question what?
My first assignment, the other assignment.
First one.
Assignment one.
But two questions to answer. Some people think or treat them as very similar. One is your contract working drawings checklist. So that's just your drawing. What information needs to be on your drawings? That's the block plan with all the RLs, your drainage points, your contour lines, your siding, frontages, side boundaries, your building heights. Your plans, your elevations, your section, your engineering.
What's an RL?
Or relief level. Real life.
Real.
Reduced level.
Sounds like.
Basically, your contour levels, your height, your form.
Okay, so like reduced life and all that.
Reduced level.
Real levels. Relevant levels.
Yeah. And then the building permit application checklist.
Where is it?
This is the first assignment.
Yeah.
Task three.
A and B. First one.
Well, then again, there's a full list in that on your disc.
There's also good ones on the council website as well.
Yeah. Well, there you go.
And Google.
And Google. Cool. Yeah.
The council did a very good one
just
anyway.
All I'm doing is pointing out the difference in the two questions. So some people get mixed up. And the next one, C, construction quality assurance checklist. You have to do one for each part. So it's each one would be a separate sheet. So you wouldn't expect to have one checklist, which has got the slab on, it's also got the frame on and that, because you're filling them in at different times. Once you've filled in, you're filing it away. You don't want to be pulling it out the file to continue on with. So it should be five different forms. I would expect to see the details on the job details address at the top, the date, and then a list of what you're inspecting. Now, I've had one, it was brilliant, but it was totally redundant at the same time because we've got five or six pages of itemized things I was checking for. Right? You ain't got that time to start with. And by, you know, you pick one out, so you walk down the end of the house and I'll check that out. Right, and then I've got the next one out. Walk the end of the house and I'll do that. You know, it's a week's job.
Run a marathon.
You want to condense it into sort of, well, depends on the size of the font. One or two sides, depending on what it is.
What for the whole, all five?
For each one. Okay. Yeah. For slab in the footing stage, you're going to have pre-slab and a pre-pour, right? So it, on one, you might break that down into two pages, or you might have one side, two sides. So what would you be looking for pre-steel?
Correct sizes.
Yeah. Position to start with. The size of the boxing, or it matches the depth and size of the beams, correct placement. Everything's...
Settings and things like
that. Yeah, everything that's done that needs to be done before you cover it up. And then the next one is before you pour it, it's going to be, you know, your steel, your laps, bracing, whatever it happens to be. Not necessarily a huge amount.
Bar chairs.
Yeah, bar chairs. pre-slab and prior to placement of the footings. A frame stage, that's probably going to be one of the most ones. And you might have, it'll be able to use it for stumps and bearers as well as on a slab.
That's a footing, yeah.
So it's, you know, you bring it into two parts. So floor, frame. So the frame, you know, studs, facings, room sizes, plumb, openings, openings in the correct place, lintels,
jam studs, or
jam studs, load bearing points, trusses, straight lines, plumb, amount of nails, believe it or not, in the clips. If you've checked them and ticked it, anything comes back and says, oh, something. Well, I know what I'm like. I can't remember everything. But if I check it off on my piece of paper and I'm honest with myself, yeah, I've done it. Okay, so that's what it is. The lock-up stage, pre-plaster, you're looking at straightening walls. Again, opening sizes, you're double-checking that the opening sizes are right. Plumbing, electrical.
Insulation.
Insulation, heating. Everything's in that needs to be in before the plaster goes in. Fixing stage, quality, you know, you're checking finish. Margins, checking
gaps,
square, level, plumb,
or square, all that sort of stuff.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then the final inspection, you're going through and it's a quality check, what you're going to look for, room by room. Probably, for the final one, I'd break it down to room by room, so I'd have entry. So then I'm looking at painting, floors, not floors, sorry, the ceilings, the walls,
boards.
Woodwork, doors, smoke detector. So I've checked them off, and then going into the bedroom. What am I looking for in the bedroom? I'm looking for the walls again, the painting. I'm looking at the doors, and just general appearance, marks and blemishes. Bathrooms are the bigger ones. You know, what are you looking for in the bathroom?
Tiling.
What about the tiling?
Stripe.
Spacing.
It's a bit late to be checking the straightness of the tiles at completion.
Oh, I thought you said.
But you're checking for the complete, the overall thing.
Yeah,
caulking's done.
Yeah.
The grouting, there's no pinholes. There's no broken tiles, chipped tiles. The shower screen is as it should be. Colours is another one. Take the colours off. It has perspex, right type of glass. Then you go through it like that. So that might be the biggest one of the lot. And you reuse that one in another assignment, I think, from memory. I could tell you keep quiet about that and get you redo it later on.
You would.
It's electronic age for recording.
Everybody's happy with the slab, the footing, the stumps, bearings, floor joists, all that.
All the trusses.
Trusses, yeah. Once you get it to 4i, it's basically NCC, finding the closures in the NCC, the glazing. Well, everybody's familiar with that one, what they've got to do. Remember, the first two up there is normal. They don't comply, everything else does.
Yeah, you should. It's
just a proof of life. Glazing again, more habitable room. Question 4M. You have to calculate the site and the site coverage. What's the site coverage consist of? Yeah. Of the all the brickwork. Not all the eaves, not all the gutter, all the brickwork only.
Unless the eaves are more than 500 millimetres out from the house.
Mother? Oh, a veranda type thing.
No, eaves. Like if sometimes you've got short eaves, that's fine. Don't count those. It said more than 500, 500 millimetres. Overhang.
I could check that one out myself.
So, total structure over brick.
Over brickwork.
Yeah.
So, it's the square metres of the dwelling and outbuildings and whatnot can't exceed more than 60%. And it can't exceed more than 80% for.
Permeability.
total coverings, so drives, footpaths, all that. Easiest way to get around that, if you do get that problem, don't put them in until after you get your CO. There's no checks and balances there.
Yeah. I don't pretend that's the case, do I?
Everybody knows how to work out the angle of repose? Anybody got any problems with that one?
Yeah,
it's a well calculated question, that one.
Well calculated.
Works out exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's fine, so I'm just gonna make this one up as I go, so I haven't got a clue if it's gonna work or not.
Or so the sitting rooms on the northern.
Right, so that's what I've got. I've got 200 out of the ground. The 400, so that means it's going to be 200 into the ground. Right. Here's the drain. Here's the easement. 4 metres deep, 3 metres in, it's in the middle, so that's 1.5 to there. Okay? Now, 5 meters from there to there. That means this, I've not drawn the steel, 2 meters. Okay. Come down 200. If I come down 200 there, that is the mat depth for 3,800. From there to there. I've only got 2 meters there.
Could you get a ton of water if I was involved with my
So from that point there, there's 2 meters, there's 3.8. 2 meters come down if it was drawn steel. So it wouldn't be deep enough.
No.
I would actually have to deepen that an extra 1.8. to get that 45 to go down.
So even though I failed, she wouldn't have told it that. It's a tough story.
Alright?
So it comes to the.
But then that was the problem.
Yeah.
From there to there, so if I go across there, I've got rid of that. From that point there to there, it's 3.8.
Or the double story to put the kitchen on this side.
I've only got 2 meters from there. Come down 2 meters. That would be a 45. What's left? 1.8. Do I need to deepen that by 1.8? Okay, just keep the numbers out there. I don't know if it'll work or not. And in the volume 2 of the M60, section 2, I think it is, there is a diagram of the angle of recoil explaining it.
Whereabouts is that, sorry?
Volume 2, NCC, section 2. I'm sure it is.
In this example, if they put the pipe at like nearly 4 meters in the ground, is that typical for pipes to get buried that deep?
No.
can be. It depends on the location.
Where it is.
I've been down.
It's scary getting that far down the ground.
Tell me about it. Actually had the backhoe and because of the muscle mass, so that's
the depth and the look where we could get the backhoe, he actually had to turn his bucket round the wrong way. So instead of going like that,
he was scooping up
like that.
Jeez.
And we were about 4 meters deep. So yeah, when you're standing down there, it is a little bit scary. Depending on the type of ground. Do you know what the rules are?
Not
for an excavation 4 meters deep now?
You're not supposed to be in there.
You've got to have the
shoring.
Yeah, the shoring.
And anything over 1.5, if it's going to be open for a certain amount of time, you need to inform mines and excavations or something like that. Yeah.
Just took a frame of cable, there
you go. Yeah. And you have to have a spotter. So anything more than 1500 deep. If you're in that hole, you need to have a spotter.
What's he going to do? He can't pull it out if he caves in.
Nobody can call someone out. That's the idea.
But she stands there to get paid.
Yeah, pretty
money.
Quickly to get on the ground.
When I was teaching the apprentices, they were telling me about the story about down at down the peninsula. There you go. There you go.